Hello everyone, welcome to another video. This is Pascal and I'm recording for Channel Fireball. And this week, we'll be doing another draft. I'm practicing for Nationals. I have a lot of drafts under my belt now, so I feel a lot more confident. And we have a pretty good pack here. Legion's Landing is a rare that I've never played with yet, but I know it's a very good card. Drover the Mighty is a really good card as well. Shapers of Nature is a really good card in what could be called the best archetype of the format. Nothing else here is really a consideration for me besides these three cards. Snapping Cellback, Runaground, Pterodon Knight are all nice cards, but not anywhere close to these three cards. So it's kind of like a preference choice, I would say. All these cards are like, I'm not gonna say as good, but I haven't drafted White Black a lot, so I'm actually gonna take Legion's Landing here. I don't like taking the blue-green card only because it's rarely open these days. Everyone knows that it's so good, so they don't draft it. So they like take Jade Guardian super high, and it's just really hard to actually get the blue-green deck. But it's the deck that has the highest ceiling for sure. It's just, there's so many really good synergies. So I'm taking Legion's Landing because it's a rare, I want to try it. And also, blue-green is boring. If I take Shapers of Nature there, you all know what it's doing. It's putting X-proof, flying creatures, it's killing opponents, it's pretty boring. So we're gonna try this card. I think will fit perfectly in white-black, and I do want to try white-black. So in this pack, Thundering Spineback is probably the best card, maybe alongside Seeker Squire and Tilo and Elise Knight. Those are the three cards that I would consider, essentially. I think because we took Legion's Landing, I could easily take the Knight or the Seeker Squire. I think that the Legion's Landing would fit in red-white dinos, but I think it would fit not as good in green-white dinos because it's a more defensive deck. So for that reason, I'm just taking the Seeker Squire because I kind of want to be... This card, I think, fits better in white-black. It's kind of like... It can be a mid-range deck, and in a mid-range deck, this land is just amazing. So I'm just taking a Seeker Squire there. I think the power level between three cards were close. So Vanquish the Weak is probably the card we're going to take here. I don't really understand how Rowdy Crew... Well, I guess it could still be a... I could see that card being a third pick, but it's a very good card. It looks bad because it has the word random on it, but it's a good random that you can control. So I'm not going to take it because I took this. I'm going to take the Vanquish the Weak. But if I had taken the red card in the other pack, I would definitely take Rowdy Crew here. All right, so this pack's not great for us. I'll probably end up taking this 2-drop here. The Queen's Base Soldier. If we had taken Shapers of Nature, we'd definitely want to take Deeproot Warrior or Deeproot Champion there. But there's not really any other considerations for us other than the Queen's Base Soldier, so we're just going to take that. Ooh, that's a pretty late... that's a pretty late Concrete Healing, but that tells us that we're in the right color, because there's two really good black cards, Skymarch Bloodletter and Concrete Healing. There's also a Legion Conquistador, which is a good thing to take note of, because we could get it like, well, I guess 1, 2, 3, 4, 8. So there would have to be two cards left in the pack for us to get it, not included in the land, so three cards. So it's not impossible that we wheel it. It's a card that's pretty good in White Black Vampire's grindy decks. But it's worth noting, like if we see more, we could prioritize them because there's a chance that we wheel it. Here I'm going to take Contract Healing. I wish I could take the Skymarch Bloodletter, which is a very good card. But Contract Healing is just way better. Alright. Alright, not a lot for us. I'll probably take the 2-drop and potentially play it, not sure. The Pterodon Knight is a good card, but it's not great in white-black. It's possible that it ends up being playable if we see, like... If we end up playing the Raptor Companions, the Hammer Skulls, but those are not cards that we would want to play. The Amorous Call I would always play, but the 3-1 for 3 I wouldn't play. There's a lot of 5 drops in black in the white-black vampire that often means we don't want to take Shining Aerosaur, which is a really good card, but we usually take other vampire 5 and 6 drops. So I'm going to take that 2 drop here. Maybe regret not taking the Pyrodon Knight later if we don't see, like, if we end up playing the Aerosaur. Okay, so if we were Merfolk, we'd be really happy to take River Herald's Boon. If this was like, I mean, I'm not gonna cut it because this is like the downsides of the Draft Leagues Online is that we don't play against people on our pod. So cutting cards doesn't really make anything do anything. I'm gonna take the Brazen Buccaneers here. We could still, like, we haven't seen a lot of white, so it's possible we move out of white. Okay. I guess we could be blue black. There's Sailor of Means here, which is not an amazing card, but it's fine. That card I haven't played a lot with, and I actually think that's what I'm gonna take here. It's definitely reasonable. It's pretty good with tokens too, so I'm just gonna take it. Okay, we'll take the Run Aground. Maybe be blue, who knows. Alright, that's a pretty late Innoitan Deacon. That's one of the key cards to the white-black deck. You just need like cards to pump your tokens, your small creatures, and that's one of them. Paladin of the Bloodstained is good too. I would almost always play it, but Innoitan Deacon is even more important, so I'm just going to take it. I hate that I have to pass this white card, though, because I wish I was getting white cards next pack, but who knows, I might still get some. Deadeye Tormentor is a kind of like fine slash filler card in this deck. Queen's Agent, I'll play one. Be happy to play one. Whatever. Whatever. So yeah, for like the Paladin, I wish I had taken the Paladin just so that like my neighbors to the left are like, okay, white is not open, we're not going to take any white cards pack two, and they pass me white cards, but it's the only white card I have really passed them, so I'm not too worried. And the Legion Conquistador didn't wield, by the way. Okay, in this pack, so we should consider blue or red, technically, as our second color. We first picked Lange and Landing, but there's no white. Buccaneers was not really a signal, because it's not a great card. Run Aground could be considered a signal to jump into blue, but there wasn't much, so, and there is no blue in that pack anyway. So the cards I would consider is, you know, we could be red-black pirates, and Rigging Runner is fairly good. Amorous Call, those are like the two best cards. I like Bishop Soldier. I think it's really important to the Vampire deck. And I actually think that's what I'm going to take here. That or the Amorous Call. And I really think that the Bishop Soldier, like, black-white really works when it's synergistic, so I think it's better to take Bishop Soldier and an Amorous Call here. Okay. So Kaisel Freebooter is a nice card. I like Pirate's Cutlass a lot. I think that card is really good. It's a lot better in blue-black, of course. But it's still fine in white-black, just because even if you're paying 2, it's fine because you're going to have a lot of like bodies just slaying around, like tokens and stuff, and small creatures. And we're going to have incidental pirates, like, you know, we have this for now, we have this, this is a pirate too. So I think I'm going to take Pirate's Cutlass there, but it could be wrong, maybe I should just take Freebooter. I've only played Freebooter in blue-black, where it is obviously amazing because it's a pirate, and also like you're trying to like build a tank with Marketh Empire and Pirate Scotless, so looking at their hand is like amazingly good. Yeah, I'll take the freebooter there, I think. If I don't have to play this card, I'll be happy. Okay, well, that's some really good cards for the Merfolk deck. Tempest Caller and Siren Storm Tamer. I'm going to take... It's tempting to take one of the blue cards and just jump into blue there. But we've taken this, and we haven't passed white to our left, so we should be getting white this pack. So I'm going to take Skyblade of the Legion. It's decent in the Wotan of Empire deck. It holds like Mark of the Empire. It gets pumped by that. It's just like a card that's laying around there that works well with your synergic go wide cards. I'm just going to take it. Alright. So that's annoying. There's not a lot for us. We're going to take Vampire Zeal. I'm not thrilled. If I end up playing a more aggressive version of the Vampire deck, then it's better. And I guess it's like a card that you're fine playing one of, even if you're a little bit defensive. I'm going to take that. Not quite thrilled with this pack. There's nothing great there anyway. Alright, there's Thrash of Raptors, which is the best card, but we're nowhere close to drafting that anyway. So another Deacon, a Bloodletter. I think I'm taking the Bloodletter over the second Deacon. So yeah, that's what I'm doing. Wow, that is so late. I could take another Ruthless Knave. I think two is probably too much. I don't really want another of those. I feel like I have enough twos at this point. So maybe I take this, and if I see a lot more treasure, like more contract killings, it gets just a ton better. Like, I could take this and then potentially move into blue. But that's such a stretch. We already have four white cards that are fine in our deck. And some black cards that only fit in the Vampire deck. So we'll just take the Ruthless Knave. Another Cutlass. Skittering Heartstopper. This Mythic that I haven't played yet. This card might actually be fine. Maybe I should try it. If I'm aiming for the more mid-range, grindy approach of the deck, then it's definitely going to be good. I do kind of want to take this also, now that I have the freebooter. And like I picked up some flyers, but I'm going to go for like trying mythics that I've never had before. It's a good way to see what's good and what's not, because you don't get many opportunities to get to try rares and mythics, and I feel like this is going to be one, so let's go for science. Alright, Duress is a fine sideboard card, so is the Mystify, but I think there's a chance we played that card. Queen's Commission. I think you need a lot of synergy to start playing it, such as like the 5 drop that says that drains your opponent for the number of vampires you have. This card, of course, that pumps Vampire. Also this, because we can just sack creatures, make some treasures. I think it's not impossible that I play at least one of those, despite not being a great card in its own. I'll take Skull Dodgery here over a sideboard card. I think I'll take this over the second Skull Dodgery. Wouldn't want to play two, and we don't have four drops yet. And Explorer is actually fine in our deck, considering we have 5, 6, and 7 drops. It's not a card that I'm excited to play usually, the Dire Fleet and Interloper, but when you have expensive cards in your deck, just Explorer gets a lot better. We'll take a Duress for the sideboard. Take this for the sideboard against aggressive decks. Oh, nice. That is really nice. Really happy to wield that. Pirate's Prize. Alright, so still not a lot of white in that pack. So it might still be super light on white, but we do have Empire Synergy, so we're not going to move any other colors. Ooh, Settle of Wreckage is a pretty messed up magic card. There's a Vanquished a week that I would like to have. Glorifier of Dusk is fine. I don't think I would want another Queen's Agent, so I'm just going to take Settle of Wreckage here. I also never played with it, but I've played against it, and I've had it. Our team had it in the last team sealed in Providence, and it was obviously pretty good. It just feels like the kind of card that you think would be not that good if, like, they play around it, but it's pretty hard to play around it. The format's fairly aggressive. Rune Raider is a nice card, but our deck's not that aggressive, and we have super expensive cards, so I don't really want to risk it. So I don't think it's worth it. Deathless Enchant is a nice payoff if you have a buyer deck, but I feel like if we wield that card, there's a high chance that we wield that card too. So I think I'm just going to take Contract Killing for that reason, and hope that we wield a Deathless Enchant. Okay, not a loss for us here. I don't dislike Dowsing. It's not a card I've never played with, but I've seen a lot of people play with it, and I've played against it. And it's probably at its best when you have a bunch of flyers. We do have two flyers so far, three with this guy. So this could make the way. I also like having equipment in the Vampire deck in general, so I don't know if I should pick this up. Like, flipping it is reasonable in our deck, especially with like that and that in our deck. Yeah, I'll just take it. Not 100% sure if I'll play it. But besides the 1-3 flyer there, there isn't a lot that I would have played. Okay. I guess I could take a Conquistador in case I see a bunch. Because there's nothing else I'm going to play here. Yeah. I don't think I would play Chupacabra. We only have one. I guess we have three cards that explore. Yeah, I guess maybe we'd play that. The chances of seeing a bunch of Conquistador at this point are very low. Okay, that's nice. We could take this just to make sure that we have it, in case it doesn't wheel. We could take this as just a removal, but we already have two Contract Killing and a Settle Wreckage against big creatures. So I'll just take the Deathless Enchant. Okay, there's another Chupacabra. There's also another one of those. I don't know if I would actually play two. This card isn't great in my deck, so I wouldn't mind just placing some of the three drops that I have. Yeah, sure, I'll pick it up and move this to the sideboard. Mark of the Empire is a sweet card with flyers. We don't have a ton of flyers, though. So I don't think Skmark is going to be that great there, but there's not one of those, and that card is really nice, so I'm definitely taking this. I don't like passing Mark of the Vampire, because it's just a really nice card. It steals games, but I don't think it fits that well here. It might now that we have two of those, but it wasn't the same pack. Alright, so there's the Deathless Enchant. I'm not 100% sure it was actually in, if it's the one that we wield, because I don't remember if it was pack 1 or pack 2. But there's nothing else here. I don't think I would play ever like a third of this, so I'm just going to take it and move the Queen's Agent there. Nothing that I'd play here. Maybe if I'm playing against like a super aggressive deck, I would want Queen's Agent instead of like this and Deathless Enchant, so I'll pick a second one for the sideboard. Whatever. This is like a nice Vampire deck. Turned out okay. I wish I had a little bit more 4-drops. Like, I wish I had the Paladin. I wish I had a Paladin, the 3-2 that makes a 1-1, and I wish that I had the Uncommon that makes 3 zombies. three vampires, but we can't have everything. So, but for a deck that's missing four drops, it's probably fine. Still don't know about those. We have two contract killings and a few tokens. Might end up cutting one. I'll probably cut one, actually, yeah. Don't know about this Dowsing Dagger. Guess it doesn't really matter if I give my opponents plants. I'll just put this on, like, lifelinkers. Or an Aura on a Flyer. Like, I could put it on those two flyers, this lifelinker, these lifelinkers, this flyer. So maybe Dowsing Dagger is fine. Maybe Boneyard Parley is, like, not that good. Because most of our creatures aren't that good, but we do have removal, and it, you can choose creatures in our opponent's graveyard. So I think I'll definitely play it. This Exile, which is annoying. But I'll play it because I want to try it. This feels like a 17 land deck because we have 5, 6, and 7s. But I really dislike playing 17 lands in a deck that doesn't have mana sinks. But I guess this is kind of like a mana sink. But it's also a land. This is like sort of a mana sink. This is a mana sink. And I guess if I had that in my deck, this would definitely be considered a mana sink. So I could probably cut this, add this, cut this, and play 17 lands. I like this configuration. It's possible that I should totally just be like playing this or just not be playing a 7 drop. Like maybe this over to Parley, and or not even just like another 6 drop, and instead of that just play a 2 drop or another Ruthless Knave or something like that. But I'm gonna science this. And also this. So we're gonna try things, but for the rest of the deck, I like where it's going. Welcome to round one, and I totally forgot to add lands to my deck while I was recording, so I actually ended up having 9 swamps and 10 swamps and 7 plains. We have like very few white spells, so I think 7 plains is just enough. We're gonna keep that hand. Plains. Looks like we're playing against red white, and a red white that doesn't have a 2 drop is a red white that I don't mind playing against. It's possible that he's like bigger, a little bit bigger of a red white deck. Like more dinosaurs based than aggro. Explore here. And we hit a Deacon. We don't have a 5 drop, so I'm gonna keep it on top. I already 5 lands. Put it on top. No 3 drop either. Interesting. I'll attack here. We have the choice between Bloodletter and Ruthless Knave. So the 4 drops that could be played out of red white, I'm thinking about the 3/2 paladin that makes a 1/1. I'm thinking about the 3/3/4/4 dinosaur that gets +2/+0. So thinking about the 2/2 haste explore, in which case I think it's better to play Ruthless Knave. I wouldn't mind trading with any of the cards that I said. And if he doesn't play anything, then I'm getting in for 3 instead of 2. So that just seems better. Okay, well that's not the 4 drop I was expecting. We'll attack here. He might have a trick, like Short Strike or +2/+2. Or I might just want to trade here. He's definitely behind on a race if he doesn't block. Sure. Vulture Strike. Alright, that is fine. Totally fine trading the 3 drop there. Okay, looks like you might have been missing a color this whole time. Ravenous Dagger Tooth. Alright, we'll play Deacon. Pump the Bloodletter. Attack for 4. Keep the Seeker Squire to block the Dagger Tooth. Take 2. We'll go to combat. Six mana, I'm thinking maybe he has like 4 damage for 5 mana. Maybe he has the 4/4 flash. No reason to play it there. Maybe he has 5 mana to start targeting an attacking creature, draw a card. I believe Crushing Canopy is an instant. I can't remember exactly, but I think Crushing Canopy is an instant. Let's try target flying creature or enchantment. Okay, Lightning Strike. Subtle Wreckage. Oh, that's weird. He tapped 4 mana, it didn't do anything. Play that card. No attacks. For some reason, I'm really smelling that Settle the Wreckage. Kind of want to just attack with like the Bloodletter, even though like it's pretty bad because I'm just trading. I feel like I guess I could just attack with the 4/4. It's not that bad if it gets Settled or Wreckaged. I have Deacon to pump my tokens that I have in my hand. No blocks. I don't have any effects. It goes down to 1. Now I'm thinking about the mythic rare that Wrath the board. If he has that mythic rare, definitely don't want to add something to the board. Whereas this is like a pretty good follow-up, so I'm just going to pass here. It's a pretty good follow-up because that gives me 2 tokens, and so I'd only need to draw 1 vampire to bring this back. Okay. So I guess we're getting punished a little bit for having played around the Wrath. Yeah, okay, we're getting super punished. I don't know, it just like, I would normally not play around like rares and mythics, but I don't know, the way the game played out, it's the only thing that made sense. Like, he wasn't doing anything, he had 3 cards in hand. It was just so weird. I'll play that. I'll
Guess I'll return to this and play it. Okay, so you play to land. Alright, he clearly doesn't have the Wrath Mythic. That would be the perfect spot to play it. So I still have some time. So now I can just attack with everything. I guess I should have pumped the Deacon, maybe. Yeah, it doesn't really matter. Have something there. I mean, settle the wreckage, but I think we settled that he didn't have it. Alright. Might have been a little too greedy there. Also, the previous turn, maybe I should have just played 1/1s. Just to have, like, he was at 1, so I don't really need to get in with the 1 creature. Alright, so he's solid 3 colors.
Or maybe splashing Sky Terror. He's not splashing green for sure because he had Grazing Whiptail. He had Legion's Judgment, so maybe splashing red? Yeah, I guess I can keep splashing red. Anyhow, I don't think I'm changing anything here. Queen's Agent's not at his best against gigantic creatures. Maybe even Pyrazeal is like fine this matchup. Probably better than Skull Dodgery, actually. They don't have a lot of X1s. So yeah, let's do that. This is kind of a weird hand. Because, I mean, it only has 2 lands, but it has a 2-drop. And I think because we have that card, I think I would be inclined to mulligan it because I have like 2 5s and a 7. But we have that card, which is a really good card to catch up, so I'm gonna keep it. Especially, I'm gonna draw as well, and this is kind of like defensive 2-drop. So that might work. Okay, well that's a really bad draw. We can probably manage. All right, need a 3rd land. Commune with Dinosaurs. Feeling nothing. Wow. Did my opponent just whiff with Commune with Dinosaurs? How is that even possible? Yeah, he did whiff. See it here. Put no cards into the hand. Commune with Dinosaurs. I have never seen this. I kind of feel like it's probably more likely to be a misclick than an actual whiff. Like, all the cards he played last game were dinosaurs, and you can hit a land. That's just insane. Oh, play that. Look at his hand. Alright, so he's definitely green, white, splash, red. So we'll take Ixalan's Binding. And attack 3. And he draws the mountain. If this person really missed with the Commune with Dinosaurs, he's running horribly bad now by drawing the mountain after. Whiptail's fine. Swamp. Jesus. My hand is atrocious right now. I mean, obviously, if I draw a land, I'm going to win. Okay, that could be really good. That does give me my fifth mana by attacking with a bunch of creatures, but I really need a black and not a white, so I think I put that in a graveyard. Alright, it's got white mana, so we're gonna have a game. There's a card in his hand that I think I'm missing there. Alright, there we go. I also don't understand why he didn't play Legion's Landing there. Went to plus and Dryad. So I could play Deacon to swing with like this, force him to trade with something. Well, I don't necessarily force him, but I think he would. Or I can play Contract Killing, get two extra mana, potentially next turn like cast this. But I actually think Deacon might just be better. Alright, so trade is for the Whiptail. Two draws another Plains. There goes Legion's Landing. Oh, yeah, that's the art card I was missing. Sounds good. So I'll contract killing this. Combat. Pump this guy. I'm still thinking about maybe playing the Bishop Soldier, but it's possible that my treasures are more valuable to keep around for like this. Or casting this next turn. Not like, I mean, I could pump it and it's like a fine attacker, but it's not that amazing. I'm just better attack with flyers at this point. Yeah, I won't play anything. Okay, so this is clearly an attack to just flip the Legion's Landing, but we get to just eat some creatures, so that's pretty nice. We know he has Shore Strike, which is super weird because he's essentially splashing Short Strike. Guess if he had it there. Guess if he had Short Strike, we would want him to kill this 2/3 as opposed to this Deacon. So this block sort of makes sense. Because then he has to save the Dryad instead of the Vampire.
so it doesn't gain that much life. Oh no, I should have, that was wrong. I should have cast this before combat in case I get this, but maybe I'm just casting this too. Yeah, I'm just casting this. Making it 1-1, of course. Funny because he's probably thinking that he's like somewhat ahead at this point. Well, maybe not because it's 4-4 fire, but it doesn't look that bad from his hand, but my on his hand, but my hand is just amazing. And he doesn't stand a chance here. No cards, he's just literally just doing this to gain life. Bash in with the flyers. And give this plus two. Down a four. And we'll play this dude. Pass. I think that's gonna be the scoop phase. Or not. I guess you can gain three life. I'm not even gonna play Settled Wreckage. I could just literally kill him next turn. I guess there's nothing he could have, really. Can I lose that game if I do this? Nah, there's no way. Seems like any kind of an unnecessary play. But I just can't think of something he could have that would punish us. Oh my god, I mean if you're... Okay, it's your upkeep. This could have literally been the card. Okay, this is just awful. Alright, let's play one more. Alright, round two here. We are in the draw, and we're going to keep that hand. And our mole, our opponent's on a mole to five there. He kept, and he scryed on top. It's going to be rough for him to win on a five card on the play. But everything's possible. Red, black. Our fleet hoarder. Down at 18. Another one. I feel like I'm supposed to trade with this and not the knave. That could be wrong though. I'm not thrilled about trading because I'm giving him treasure, but he has two cards in hand. And it looks like he doesn't care because he just killed it. So he's on the mega aggressive plan. And Jesus, that Skulldozer is going to be good. I'll kill his two creatures and not lose a card. Well, I'll lose the Skulldozer, I guess. Alright, so plus one, minus one. I'll get two treasures. Hopefully he doesn't play Burning Sun's Avatar. That's one of the worst things I could think of. Okay, that's a pretty good one. To make up for the multi five. Draws Skulldozer. I can attack here. I think there's no way. I don't think he's going to block. I guess he could block with a 2-1. But I don't think he will. Okay, interesting. Then he's left with no creatures. That's a pretty good spot for Boneyard Parley. Oh, and I could have got blown there because he has Skulldozer in hand, and hopefully it needs two targets. And I waited after he got the treasure to cast the Vanquished the Weak on the Ruin Rider, so he could have give +1/+1, but hopefully it needs two targets, so it doesn't work. But it was still wrong. Like, I should have just done it before he gets the treasure. So there, I could block, but I'm trading with the Skulldozer, so it's not great, so I think I don't block. That's interesting. Is that a Yume flip or not? Yeah. Yeah, I'm just not gonna flip it. I'm winning this race very easily. I'll flip it next turn when I attack if I need to. But this is like a 3-turn clock, so that seems pretty good. Attack. No flip. And I guess we'll cast that. Return. One. Two, three, four, five. I think we don't take Ruin Raider because that's like the one of the only way we could potentially lose the game, because it's not a Yume. Okay, you just conceded. But yeah, what I'm saying is, like, it's not a Yume, and we do have 5s and 6s in our deck. We still have 1-6 left. We still have, like, 3-5s, and that's, like, one of the only way you could lose the game, so I would have taken that pile there. Alright, so we're playing against red black aggro. So Queen's Agent on the draw. Looks like it might be better than Deathless Ancient. Actually, probably better than Boneyard Parley.
Could have like extra two drops. This is a good two drop against aggressive decks, especially against. It's a good way to fight their Dire Fleet order. It's just a trade with our own, so we also get the ramp. This is also a good card at fighting the 2/1, the 2/1s for two. Dead Sea 3, but it's a pretty bad card on its own. So, and we already have tokens that are really good against that. So I'm definitely putting in one Queen's Agent over the Boneyard Parley, and I really don't think it's that necessary. I mean, maybe it's wrong to think that he's that aggro though. It looked aggro because he drew like he couldn't maneuver a lot because he multi five and he was stacking with twos. So maybe he's not actually that aggro. But red black is an archetype that is aggro, so I'm gonna assume that he is. This doesn't seem very good in the matchup. Could see boarding that out. So I could board out those two for like those two. So the Queen's Aid in the order. Yeah, I like that. Okay, this hand is great. Okay, might not be that aggro. I feel like I have somehow a lot more planes than swamp every game, and I have 10 swamps and 7 planes. We'll take that. Place that guy. Take three. Duress. We'll take the contract killing, of course. Probably use it to block at this point. I don't really want to lose it to removal. But I guess this is like a lot better to keep on defense though. Or like, I'd rather have this skill than this. Yeah, I guess I'm passing. Interesting. Got a swamp. Yeah, we'll block one of those. Could play Freebooter. Might have like contract killing in his hand. It's also pretty good to display this and equip it, and the next turn I can attack, flip it, have a ton of mana. But I guess I can do that either way. I can play both, and then next turn, flip this, like equip an attack on the Freebooter. Oh wow. That is some literal. My opponent's a book. I'm just gonna say that. And I can read books. Actually, that's not even true. I'm not gonna say which is not true. Alright. We'll play, probably just take three there. Why would he not attack with the that's weird. Okay. Makes more sense.
Oh, wow, you drew another one. So, I could attack, flip the dagger, and I net a mana, and that way I can cast this. Could cast Deacon. I'm just gonna cast Deacon. It's gonna die. And then maybe I can cast Deathless Enchant. Usually I would want the other way around, but I don't have enough vampires to be able to flip to return this like soon. So I'd rather have this skilled at this point. Yeah. It's a bummer. This card's getting pretty annoying. Oh no. Okay. If he hits a spell. Okay. If he had a spell there, that would have been devastating. Come on, 4-mana exile creatures would be so good. Okay, that's also not bad. And I put it here. Which is weird, usually you would want it on the lifelinker, but I think this is just gonna trade with this. I guess I could I have done the other way around, like I put it on the bishop, I block a 2-2, but then I put the skyline on the fleet and it doesn't die, so I have to do it that way. Okay. And now I sit. And I hope he doesn't draw too well. Hope I win the top deck war. Put that here. Man, if this was flipped, this game would be a lot easier. We have to take one. Oh wow, that's perfect. It's tempting to just attack for 6 and then move the dagger, but we're so ahead. Well, we're not ahead. We are ahead in a way that we're gonna probably win the late game, and so I just don't want to risk, like, you know, getting dual shotted or something and being anywhere. I don't think it's just worth attacking there. Does kill him a lot faster, which, you know, could be a deal breaker, but I have a lifelink to get out of range of burn spells. My late game is like generally pretty good. Should be better than his, at least. Okay, that's strong. Taking it. That is pretty good. Just play it. Explore, and we'll keep that on top. Pass again.
think that's the kind of spot where I just equip the vampire. Actually, I just attack with everything and flipped. And I flipped the Legion's Landing, alright. I gain a ton of life. Yeah, that seems good. That's fine. That more up to 10. I can make a 1-1. But I can also just play this and then equip it. Alright, we win. We'll be in the final. Alright, on the play for the last match and all the marbles. And we're gonna keep this. Thousand Dagger's been nice. It's probably been better than I think it is. It's fairly close to Pirate's Cutlass, which is an amazing card. Not a land, please. God damn it. Alright, no more land for the rest of the game now. That's a good draw. Okay. I think I play that. Ooh, looks like the mirror match. He has 5 cards left. So I guess that would be those 3, 4, 5. Okay, these 5. So doesn't have white. We'll attack with these. Obviously, he knows that we have a trick now that I'm attacking with the 1/2. So +1 and -1. Alright, it's been getting pretty gross. Maybe that was wrong to put it on a freebooter. He has a removal to kill it, then I have to spend 2 more mana to... I should have put it on 2/2. I'm not transforming. Another swamp. To be fair, our opponents haven't been the luckiest. But our deck also cooperated the way it should. No. Uh, And he didn't draw the land. Alright, so mirror match. In the mirror match, this could be fun to some extent. Kind of grindy cards like this also would be fine. Maybe Chupacabra is fine too, but I have... Yeah, I don't have enough explorers. Boneyard Parley is going to be great. So I'm considering these two, essentially. I didn't get to do anything with this so far, but I feel like the games could sort of stall, and this might be better than like this. But I still kind of want to have this in my deck. I'm not sure what I should cut for it. Also, I don't think Vampire Zeal is good, actually. This is just better. Soul Tormentor. Could be over just like a 2-2. But I'm on the draw, so I don't like cutting twos. Maybe this guy. But I do like that it bridges to the 5 and 6s and 7s by just drawing a card. The other card I'm considering is like swap this for this. So the reason I want this is that it's kind of grindy and like clearly it needs most of his land drops and he's gonna have like 5s and 6s in his deck, as we saw in this game. So I think it's this or Boothless Knave. I don't think it's this. Or maybe I just don't board it in. Maybe this is better. Yeah, I'll keep this and see what happens with it. We just didn't really get to try it, so.
Try now. Okay, well, that's a keep. It's not super exciting, because we don't have white, but I have two plays, and this can create us white mana if we want to. Like, if we get to... And, like, I like keeping these kind of hands that can easily get behind, because then Settle Wreckage just gets insane. Here. Definitely has slash of talons, +2/+2 first strike or something. I guess I'm not blocking. I'll wait to have this up. It's also my source of white, potentially. Now I'm blocking since I have this up. Wow, he just has like nothing. Am I supposed to crack itself? For white mana so that I can cast this and this? I think it's fine. It's weird. This also gives me mana if I flip this. Gives me white mana. Need to be able to attack. Queen's Agent is going to be a play there. If it is, then Vanquished, having mana for Vanquished to weaken response to their Explore trigger would have been real good. I think I just don't block to maximize the chances of being able to attack next turn with three creatures. Oh well, that's a pretty good response. So I respond by giving it plus one and then minus one on this. It's a pretty funny answer. His hand can't be all... His hand can't be all, like, double black spells, right? He might still have plus two first strike, I don't know. And didn't want to save his 1-1 there. Anyhow, I'm gonna play Deacon. Another white mana. Another Queen's Commission. What do I do here? I could contract killing so that I can cast this next turn. I can't really attack with this because I don't want him to triple block. If he triple blocks, I can play this, but then he can easily have something else. Like a trick. I guess I'm sitting, like, I'm not in a rush at all. I have this for the late game, my hand's really good. Like, even if he gets to his mana, then I have answers to big threats. Probably just attacking with that. I feel like I could easily use a contract killing for efficiency the other turns. Okay, that's a nice draw. Now I'll attack with the Deacon. Yeah, so I'm expecting Slash Italians or... +2/+2. So if it is +2/+2, then I just wait and I vanquish the weakened response. But if it's Slash of Talons, I pass priority there. Then he'll let damage happen and he'll do it. Okay, didn't. That's a weird block then. Like, usually what you do is that you let damage happen, and then before end of combat, whilst in attackers, you can slash the talons. But it wasn't the end of the world, so I wouldn't mind that much losing yet. Which is why I didn't vanquish the weak, like, before damage. Which is just kind of dumb. Kukir's Galleon. Interesting. Pump this, actually. Don't care about the lifelink anymore. Box this to save a bunch of damage. Alright, now he has it. I think he clicked through the other turn. He forgot to put a stop or something. That's pretty interesting.
You can go to combat, pump as Deacon, and then attack with the Galleon. Which is sort of annoying, because now he has this really good land. I could probably still beat it. And I'll take two. I won't risk plus two or two damage. No point when I have 28 life. It's a decent draw. Loot. Planes, and we'll just play one of those. Another one of those, I should say. And he finally got, yes, his second swamp. So it's probably casting either Contract Killing or a 4-4 Flyer. Hopefully to 4-4 Flyer, that way you can just do that and win the game. Alright, well that went well. Tap lands and concedes. So obviously our opponent didn't get that didn't get super lucky. I think our opponent's deck round one was clearly misbuilt or misdrafted in some way. There's no way you play three colors and like splash Shore Strike. And we have had opponents like Mulligan and have mana problems. But overall I still think this black-white Vampires deck was pretty good, and I think this is how it should be drafted. It was definitely missing some four drops like Paladin and Call to the Feast, but it's still managed. Like you just need some of the payoffs. Like you want to stall the game, you don't have the tools to be that aggressive, so you need to stall the game and have really good payoffs, and you also need to have really good removal because your creatures are not that big, so you're able to stall the small creatures, but the big creatures you need to kill them in order to get to your late game payoffs like this and Deacon and stuff. We didn't get to blow out anyone with this, but I still think it's pretty messed up. So thank you for watching. I'll see you next week.